Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 14405 in the name of Graeme Simpson on ending peak rail fares on ScotRail trains. I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Graeme Simpson to speak to and to move the motion up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. I'll start by moving the motion in my name. Presiding Officer, just before Parliament returned from the summer recess, Fiona Hislop announced that peak fares will be returning to Scotland's railways. There was no debate. That was it. Mm-hmm. Well, here's the debate today, and Parliament can speak and give its view, and I hope the Government listens. Transport Scotland declared the trial of having a simpler and lower fare structure to have been unsuccessful, even though it led to more people using the trains. And so, having raised fares by 9% in April, passengers are to be hit with a double whammy in just 16 days' time, which will result in someone commuting between Edinburgh and Glasgow facing fares nearly double what they were paying at the start of the year. Now, when Fiona Hislop faced a barrage of questions on this last week, all she had in her locker was a bizarre claim that you will actually pay less if you take advantage of season tickets or something called a flexi-pass, which friends tell me is fiendishly complicated, all of which begs the question of the Transport Secretary: if there's money for her new complicated rail discount schemes, why doesn't she use some of it to scrap peak fares, which passengers overwhelmingly prefer?
Cabinet Secretary. So I'd point the member to his own Central Scotland region. I'm sure he's a regular rail user. Currently, in terms of the funding in relation to Airdrie to Edinburgh in his region, if you use an annual season ticket 4 days a week, it would be £14.44. The current pilot fare is £15.80. On terms of good use of public financing, the self-financing of the discounts is a benefit to the public purse, but more importantly, a benefit to passengers, and I'm sure he and all his colleagues will be encouraging members to use them.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, my fare from East Kilbride to Edinburgh is going to rocket by 83.88%. That's not a saving. In March, a letter was issued from ASLEF, RMT, Unite, TSSA, Scottish Trades Union Congress and Stop Climate Chaos, Transform Scotland, Friends of the Earth Scotland and the Just Transition Partnership to Fiona Hislop. And this read, if you were to restore peak fares, it would be a retrograde step that would send exactly the wrong message at the wrong time. We urge you to do the right thing, scrap peak fares permanently to help Scotland meet its climate targets. Mike Robinson of Stop Climate Chaos will be delighted that I'm quoting him, but I am, because he said in March, if we're serious about tackling the climate crisis, along with reducing inequality and improving health and well-being, it's a no-brainer that using public transport should be cheaper than driving. And I wouldn't want to leave out my good friend Kevin Lindsay of ASLEF, who said in May, surely, just at the time the Scottish Government has backtracked on its net zero targets, they should be doing all they can to make our trains more affordable and reduce CO2 emissions from road travel, which their own policy is committed to. And not for the first time, Mr Lindsay is bang on the money, as is Alex Rowley, whose amendment we will support because it retains the motion calling on the Government to reverse this retrograde step. The Government amendment does not do that, so should be rejected. And I should say that I would also have been happy to support the Green Amendment too, had that been accepted, and I give credit to them for their work in getting peak fares scrapped in the first place, although, of course, others were also calling for the same thing. Now, if we want to get people to use public transport instead of driving in greater numbers, then we have to make it simple and affordable. But the service also has to be reliable, and it has not been. Almost 6,000 ScotRail trains have been cancelled since April, and over £250,000 has been paid out in compensation for delayed or cancelled trains. £2 million has been paid out since the nationalisation that was supposed to make things better. So we have an unreliable service, and now it's to be more expensive. So if your policy is to get more people onto the roads, then this is genius. Now, Fiona Hislop has not been able to explain how increasing fares will help the Scottish Government to achieve its ambition of cutting car miles by a fifth by 2030. The Dyer programme for Scotland last week warned darkly of demand management measures. So while you might be tempted to hop in the car rather than taking the train from now on, drivers of Scotland, beware. The SNP are coming for you. They just aren't saying what they have in store yet. Maybe it's road pricing. Well, they'll certainly coin it in on that at this rate. Now, presiding officer, it may surprise members to know that I don't always agree with the RMT, but last week they produced a critique of this backward decision that was spot on. They said, quite rightly, that the evaluation of the trial only looked at the impact on overall demand and did not assess the impact on demand in peak time only. And I'll give way very briefly to Mr. Stewart.
I thank Mr. Simpson for giving way, and it's a pity that the off-peak fares pilot did not create the greater patronage that was expected to cover the costs. Can I ask Mr. Simpson if he himself took full advantage of the full fares pilot to switch to rail travel from his region to Parliament? Did he urge his staff to do likewise? And did he urge others to do so too?
Graeme Simpson.
Too late.
I regularly use the train, and my staff use the train all the time. It's just going to become more expensive for them now, and that's a real shame. Yeah. And Mrs. Stewart should know that. Now, I think Fiona Hislop should have sent back the evaluation on the basis that I've just outlined. The evaluation also measured passenger demand in terms of journey numbers rather than distance travelled, which could give a different picture. The Transport Secretary has said the trial costs around £40 million. The RMT suggests the actual figure is nearer to £20 million because without the trial, passenger numbers would have increased similar to the rest of the UK. I think they're right. It's not small change, but it should be seen as investment. Presiding officer, public transport should be seen as a service. It should become the go-to choice. And when times are tough for people, we should not be making things harder. The reintroduction of peak fares should be reversed, as the motion in my name says, and I call on Parliament to do the right thing and back it.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I now call on Fiona Hislop, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and move Amendment 14405.3. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name. Last October, we introduced the ScotRail peak fares removal pilot, supported by £40 million in government funding. Doing so was a bold and pioneering initiative, which was only possible due to this government bringing ScotRail into public sector control, and which has not been done elsewhere in the UK as yet. We initiated the pilot to achieve two objectives: to encourage more people to choose to travel by train rather than by car, especially at peak commuter times, and to make rail travel more affordable and accessible. On Tuesday, the 20th of August, Transport Scotland published its full analysis of the ScotRail peak fare removal pilot, and I would encourage members to read it if they have not already done so. This analysis shows that while there has been a limited increase in the number of passengers during the pilot at the optimal level of 6.8%, it did not achieve its original aims of encouraging a significant modal shift from car to rail. Now, it suggests that around 4 million extra rail journeys during the pilot were made, of which 2 million are journeys that would have previously been made by private car. However, this is in the context of around 5 billion annual private car journeys in Scotland and represents a reduction of less than 0.1% of car-based carbon emissions. Now, of those new rail passengers identified as switching from other modes, 54% had previously used a car as a driver and a third had switched from bus. The The evidence also suggests that the pilot primarily benefited existing users who tended to be above average income. Presiding officer, the First Minister set out this government's priorities in his programme for government on the 4th of September. Due to the 14 years of austerity, driven by the previous Conservative and continued by the current Labour Westminster governments, sky-high inflation and the failure of the Westminster government to adequately increase budgets to address that fact means we have to make difficult decisions to address those circumstances. Mr Simpson.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention, but when she announced this decision, she herself admitted that in some cases people have saved thousands of pounds, in her words. So does she now agree with me that it will now cost people thousands of pounds?
Cabinet Secretary.
So on the basis of saving many passengers hundreds and in some cases thousands of pounds during the past period, it primarily benefited existing train passengers and those with medium to higher incomes of above £35,000. So on the basis of looking at the priorities of tackling child poverty, and we've just had a debate on that, and also tackling climate change, on those measures, I made the decision to end the trial of the discounted fares from the 30th of September because it would be difficult to justify that kind of subsidy having not made its aims as set out originally. Sorry, I can't give way. I'm limited for time. Presiding officer, I wanted the pilot to succeed, and I am disappointed it has not. But the moderate increase in passenger levels, while welcome, was significantly below the 10% increase needed to make the scheme self-financing. In the current climate, it is simply not affordable to continue with this level of additional cost, especially when the scheme did not result in a large-scale switch from car to train, so will have had a minimal impact on carbon emissions. However, there is a significant minority of people who cannot choose when they travel to and from work, people who might find the return to peak fares challenging. So I have therefore instructed ScotRail to introduce a 12-month discount on all ScotRail season tickets, weekly, monthly and annual ones, and to permanently amend the terms of flexi passes to allow for 12 single journeys for the price of 10 used within 60 days, a saving of 32% compared to 6 anytime return tickets. So super off-peak day return fares will return, offering even cheaper fares for those who can travel at less busy times. These measures will offer significant savings from previous peak fare levels for many and may still encourage people to make the switch from car to train for their daily commute. And should Labour rediscover their purpose and recognise that you cannot cut your way to prosperity or to improve public services, if UK government budget allocations significantly improve, presiding officer, I remain open to reconsidering future investment to fund the removal of ScotRail peak fares.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Alec Riley to speak to and move Amendment 14405.2. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Presiding officer, I move the amendment in my name. First, I want to highlight the difference in approach between the SNP and Scottish Labour on the issue of peak rail fares. The SNP view seems to be that withdrawn peak fares was given workers who travel to and from work at certain times of the day by train a subsidy. Scottish Labour view peak fares as a tax on workers who use the train to get to and from work. In other words, workers are penalised if they have to use the train between certain hours of the day to get to and from work. And when the Cabinet Secretary says this pilot mostly benefited those with medium to higher incomes, we need to talk about what that means. Middle earners may mean one thing to the SNP, but I have been contacted by nurses, teaching assistants, a janitor, a hotel worker, all frontline workers who would fall into the category of middle earners, according to the SNP. None of those workers felt it was fair to be charged a premium for overcrowded and unreliable train services that they rely on getting them to and from their work. But even if we accept the SNP view that removing peak fares is a subsidy to middle earners, then I would ask that we be realistic about the chance of getting more people to leave the car at home and travel by rail. Because if you want people to move from car to public transport, ultimately these measures will have to benefit middle earners, as they are more likely to be driving than people on low incomes. Inspiring modal shifts means targeting those that are driving and giving them a reason to change their mode of transport. That must mean making rail affordable, accessible and reliable, in order to ensure that it is cheaper, or it certainly needs to be cheaper, to use the car than it is to use the train. Then I would suggest modal shift, if we don't do that, will continue to be an uphill struggle that we will not meet. Indeed, I saw John Swinney recently said that he believed the government would still achieve the reduction of 20% in car kilometres travelled by 2030. Personally, I think that is pie in the sky. But in reality, the SNP are unlikely to be in power by then, so it's easy to make targets for the future, then take little action to actually make them happen. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government are trying to sell this removal of peak fares as a failure. But during an unprecedented time of SNP chaotic mismanagement that saw delays, cancellations and the imposition of an emergency time... I've got a few minutes left. During this time, unprecedented time, of SNP chaotic mismanagement that saw delays, cancellations, the imposition of an emergency timetable, rail use increased by 6.8%, which I actually think was incredible given all of that. Just think of the result that could have been if people could rely on the services and the scheme was appropriately advertised at the start, instead of hidden due to concerns of overcrowding on trains. The only way this pilot has been a failure is in its management and its execution. Even with the removal of peak fares, driving is still cheaper than it is to use rail. So to achieve modal shift on the scale we need to, public transport must be the most affordable and reliable option. So I would urge all members, if we are serious about hitting our net zero targets, if we're serious about tackling the transport issues, then we have to invest in public transport. It has to be reliable. People need to know that when they go for public transport, they'll be able to access
it. Mr. Reilly, you are over your time.
Affordable.
Thank you,
support the motion.
Thank you. I now call on Mark Ruscoe. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. And can I start by welcoming that the Tories have chosen the cream of the crop of Scottish Green policies to champion in the Chamber this afternoon. Now, whether this is just blatant opportunism or a stumble towards one nation conservatism, I don't know. But it's clear that the Tories have noticed the popularity of removing extortionate and confusing peak rail fares. Now, the Scottish Greens listened to rail unions and championed the scrapping of peak fares when we were in government. Rail union members work with passengers every day, and they know how the railway works and how ludicrously complex the fare system is and how it puts passengers off. Now, the RMT have called the decision to reintroduce peak fares a retrograde step. ASLEF has said the decision was a disaster for workers, and I wholeheartedly agree with the STUC, who said peak fares are a stealth tax on workers, which is bad for the climate, bad for our communities, and bad for people's wallets. Now, public transport is a common good. It's at the heart of everyday life, and how we get to work and access learning, how we visit our family and friends, how we engage with our communities, it delivers tangible, positive benefits for all. And if the government is serious about its commitments to cutting emissions from the 5 billion car journeys made in Scotland every year and transforming the way people travel, we need to see that radical investment into making the bus, tram and train cheaper and easier than taking the car. So a robust route map on reducing car kilometres by 20% by 2030 will be vital to this, and I look forward to the Cabinet Secretary producing that soon. Now, nearly 750,000 young people in Scotland now have access to free bus travel, and more than 150 million of those journeys have been made in just over 2 years. And of course, the National Entitlement Card for bus travel goes further by offering young people 50% off their train fares. So we're already creating a generation whose first choice is public transport. But I would say to the Cabinet Secretary that it takes time to change behaviour. The peak fare trial led to an extra 4 million journeys over 9 months, half of which would have been made previously by car. It didn't pass the success threshold the government set of a 10% increase in journeys, but people take time and they need certainty to make changes to their lives. And at the end of this month, the only certainty will be that fares will dramatically increase on many rail services. If there's time in hand, Presiding Officer...
There's not any time in hand, okay, so it's up to the member.
I need to progress. Sorry, Mr Finlay. Sorry, Finlay. Ticket prices for the most popular Edinburgh to Glasgow route will nearly double from £14.90 to a staggering £31.40. And this is a step in the wrong direction. It cannot be right that it is cheaper, easier and simpler to choose private cars over public transport. And the Fair Fares Review, the government's own Fair Fares Review, also recognised that rail fares are extremely complex, act as a barrier to encouraging modal shift from car to rail. Simplification of fares and tickets is key to encouraging people onto public transport, and the off-peak all-day scheme was a great start to that. Returning to a complex picture of multiple ticket prices sends us back in the wrong direction and risks passengers abandoning rail altogether and getting back onto the road again. So we may also see a return, maybe, to overcrowding on either side of the peak fare timetable as passengers scrabble to avoid eye-watering prices, leading to a poor customer experience, further fuelling frustration and further fuelling a decline in the use of rail. So, Presiding Officer, if passenger numbers go in reverse because of this decision to bring back peak fares, ScotRail's farebox income will plummet. And then the Cabinet Secretary will have no option but to finally scrap peak fares permanently. So, Presiding Officer, it's in this context the Scottish Greens are content to back the motion and the Labour amendment to today's debate. And I look forward to reflecting on members' comments in the closing speeches.
Thank you, Mr Ruscoe. And I now call on Beatrice Wishart. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak on behalf of Scottish Liberal Democrats this afternoon. We will support the motion this evening and the Labour amendment. We will not be supporting the Scottish Government's amendment. The reintroduction of peak fares comes a few months after the announcement in April of a rise in fares of 8.7%, a double whammy for commuters during a cost-of-living crisis. Some will now be incentivised off the rail network and back into cars. There will be plenty of real-world experiences out there illustrating the barrier the return of peak fares will make to their commute, as well as a question about the reliability of the rail service. Passengers need reliability. Many experiences highlight commuters finding other means to get to work rather than rail, which perhaps impacted the success of the pilot. It was hoped that this policy had the climate and sustainable transport in mind. The Scottish Government's own announcement stated that a 10% increase in passenger levels would have made the policy self-financing, which begs the question, why was the Scottish Government unable to achieve this magic number? What more spending would have been needed to ensure a successful public engagement programme to develop a self-financing policy and sustainable rail service? Indeed... Yes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I point out there were four campaigns during the course of this, with 4 million views reached. Paid TV, radio, podcast, My Town received an A3 fold-out print. So therefore, in terms of that advertising engagement, particularly tackling with radio car users, you can't say it wasn't advertised.
Beatrice Wishart.
The RMT briefing states that it believes that the Scottish Government's methodology used to evaluate the trial did not look at the demand in peak time, making it difficult to see the true impact of the trial. The climate will be the biggest loser of this policy reversal. Scottish Liberal Democrats have long campaigned to get cars and lorries off the roads, moving passengers and freight onto our railways as part of a package to tackle the climate crisis. We also championed reforms to ticket incentives and discounts. Rail fares will now revert to the more complicated tiered system of super off-peak off-peak and peak rail fares. If you were to design a ticket pricing system designed as a barrier to travel on our railways, then this is what you would create. Since the pandemic, it's been clear that more people are choosing to work flexibly, with a mix of some days working from home and some days commuting. 2- and 3-day-a-week rail season tickets would provide flexibility and reflect new hybrid models of working, saving commuters money. I note the Scottish Government's 12-month discount on ScotRail season tickets and new flexi passes, allowing commuters to book 12 single journeys for the price of 10. But these must be simple to use and purchase, and with straightforward terms and conditions to ensure usability and good uptake. It's about fostering a culture of sustainable public transport use that is good for both purses and planet. To conclude, we need to invest to cut our carbon emissions. Whether investing in public awareness campaigns of discounts and passes, reopening stations, building new lines, adding new stations to existing routes. And it's not just railway infrastructure investment that will help to reduce carbon emissions. Ferries to our island and coastal communities need to be sustainable and, dare I say, for some communities, tunnels to reduce emissions would be a sustainable alternative to recurring cycles of ferry replacements. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wishart. We now move to the open debate. Backbench speeches of up to 4 minutes and there's no time in hand. I call Craig Hoyt, to be followed by Ben McPherson. Mr Hoyt.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Despite his authoritarian misrule, Benito Mussolini is credited with making Italy's trains run on time. But in fact, a look back in time reveals that he didn't, because that was a myth. Instead, Mussolini was a showman. He never missed an opportunity to be associated with great public works, and railways were amongst his favourites. Whenever a big rail bridge or a station or a new line opened, Mussolini was there to take the credit. Whether he would go as far as launching a ship with painted-on windows is another matter, but there is a similarity between the tactics deployed by Il Duce and the modern-day SNP, because last December, Fiona Hislop was in East Lothian, smiling for photographers when she proudly opened East Linton Station, a very warmly welcomed station and much needed by the community. Now...
Point of order, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm just interrupted. Obviously, I can hear one of the members at the back shouting fascist across. Maybe, I don't know if you've heard that, Presiding Officer, but just wondering how you... I think that's disgraceful, how it's...
Mr Fitzpatrick, not from a second position. If Mr Fitzpatrick has something to say, Mr Fitzpatrick should stand up and say it, otherwise he should keep quiet. Is Mr Fitzpatrick making a point of order?
Happy to do a point of intervention if the member...
You don't intervene in a point of order. OK, Mr Lumsden, thank you for your contribution. I did hear that, and I'd hoped that Ms Fitzpatrick would desist from making any further comment.
Oh, my God.
Mr Fitzpatrick, I'm in the middle of responding to a point of order, thank you. And I'd hoped that that would happen. I do note your point of order. I have listened to the content carefully of what Mr Hoy has said, and in my view, at the moment, it is debating points and nothing in terms of the substance of the claim from a seconded position that was made. But obviously, I will listen very carefully. Now, before we go back to Mr Hoy, I take the point of order from Mr Fitzpatrick.
Thanks very much. I think for clarity, I need to make the point that when I'm saying a fascist, I was talking about Mussolini, and I think it's I think it's stretching to be comparing a Scottish Government minister with a fascist in Italy. I thought it was shameful.
Thank you, Mr Fitzpatrick, for your contribution. I didn't for one second assume you were referring to Mr Hoy, so that's all good. With regard to the second point that you made, I actually listened carefully when Mr Hoy started down that route, and my feeling was that Mr Hoy was in no way making a claim vis-à-vis the substantive point that you make towards the Cabinet Secretary. Otherwise, I would have intervened in a heartbeat. I did not feel that that was what he was doing. He was seeking to be humorous. Of course, it will be up to the Chamber to decide, and the members of the public watching, whether he succeeded in that regard or not. Mr Hoy, please continue.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I also read the history books. So let's say he was a showman for the purposes of this. And last December, Fiona Hislop was also a showwoman because she arrived in East Lothian smiling for photographers when she opened East Linton Station. But now, months later, services have been slashed and peak time fares are soaring. And as a result of the SNP's restricted and emergency timetable, there are only 5 trains a day from East Linton to Edinburgh, with only 2 trains each morning and only 1 single ScotRail service each day. And anyone wanting to return after 5:42 p.m. will have to wait until 11 p.m. to get home, Minister. Trains are meant to take 20 to 30 minutes, half the time off the local East Coast bus service. But this coming Saturday, a passenger... I won't actually, because I've taken enough interruptions as well, and I think I'm probably on the clock. This coming Saturday, Minister, a passenger boarding the 6:09 a.m. service bound for Edinburgh faces a 2-hour and 11-minute journey involving a rail replacement bus south of Dunbar, a 1-hour wait on the platform before boarding a northbound London train to Edinburgh. That's 2 hours and 11 minutes to go just 23 miles. And the shot for this shocking level of service, the single fare, is £9.90. The only saving grace is that the train is operated by LNER rather than SNP-run ScotRail, so passengers will be able to have a drink to quell their understandable anger. Presiding officer, under the SNP, service levels on our railways are shocking and ticket fares are scandalous. And people living in East Linton are not alone. Commuters from North Berwick are set to see peak fares soar despite a reduced service, with ticket prices rising by 70% from £8.80 to a staggering £15. And that is why today I urge colleagues from across the Chamber to join the Scottish Conservatives in calling for the Scottish Government to reverse plans to reintroduce peak fares. This decision, Minister, will be disastrous for passengers, punishing hard-working Scots who will now have to pay hundreds and, by her own concession, thousands of pounds more to commute to work. Deputy Presiding Officer, people are being forced back into their cars, resulting in increased congestion on the A1 and damage to the environment. Ticket prices are already up 9%. Peak fares are returning. A reduced timetable is causing misery for commuters. Far too many Scottish services are being cancelled, a staggering 6,000 and counting since April alone. And satisfaction levels with public transport are plummeting. Last week, I spoke in this chamber of the SNP's reverse Midas touch. Everything which they touch turns to dust. It is a sorry state of affairs, not just for residents in East Lothian, but across the south of Scotland region that I represent. And it is a state of affairs that is being played out across our transport network and our public services. And it is a state of affairs, the blame for which lies solely at the feet of this SNP government.
Thank you, Mr Hoy. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Mr McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And just considering the last contribution that was made, I think Conservative colleagues who've brought this debate should consider that the people that we represent know what is going on across these aisles and know about the absolute folly of privatisation of the rail services from the 1990s by the Conservative Party, which is having ramifications to this day. For example, the very, very long delay through the night that some of my constituents experienced on the Avanti service just a few days ago, which has been reported in the Scotsman in the last days. Also, we know that comparatively with elsewhere, the value for money that consumers receive from ScotRail is superior. And what we also know is that there is strong support across the country for the fact that ScotRail has been taken into public hands since 2022. And I'm a bit perplexed by members to the left of me and on the Conservative benches who I've heard in previous contributions speak critically about public ownership of ScotRail, but now seem to be demanding a continued subsidy that is only able to be utilised and delivered because of public ownership. So, I mean, what do the Scottish Conservative Party stand for in this instance? You know, are they in favour of public ownership or not? It's a mystery. Please enlighten me.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, can I thank Ben McPherson for taking the intervention? Would Ben McPherson not accept that this is about the way ScotRail is run? It's now nationalised. And, you know, surely he would accept that putting fares up, as is about to happen in just over 2 weeks, is not what should be happening. Does he accept that?
So
that wasn't an answer to the question I put. And what we know is that the nationalisation of ScotRail has enabled this subsidy, this £40 million of public money, to be used to reduce fares at a time when there was a cost of living crisis, which of course for many families was induced by the folly of the Liz Truss government and the effect that had on their mortgage costs and elsewhere. And also the damage that the pandemic brought to the economy and the fact that reducing fares helped with the economic stimulus of recovery. And what I've not heard from the Conservative benches again today is, you know, what recurring spend would they cut elsewhere in the revenue budget in order to meet this £40 million? You know, and we haven't heard that from the Labour Party. In fact, for the last 2 weeks, on all the issues of public finance, we haven't heard any detailed proposals from the Labour Party about how they would change spending priorities. Just sweeping statements of criticism without serious policy proposals or solutions. So we're in this situation where the Scottish Government, through nationalisation, through the right choices, has been able to bring in a subsidy. It's made an impact that's been positive in the period that it has taken place. And we know that the investment that is going into ScotRail is making an improved service for people every single week, going up more and more. And the Cabinet Secretary set out the savings and methods, whether that's the fact that the ScotRail tickets are already some of the lowest in the UK, with being 20% lower on average compared with the rest of the UK. We heard about the flexi passes, all these initiatives that are already in place, and of course what the Cabinet Secretary announced to committee, to Parliament last week, about the improvement in the rolling stock that is to come. So public ownership has made a positive impact. This policy has made a positive impact, and I commend the Government for doing that.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Richard Leonard. Mr Kerr.
Thank you. It was notable that Ben McPherson couldn't answer the intervention from Graeme Simpson. He seems to not be able to make a judgment on whether or not it's a good thing that many of our constituents are about to be faced with what Alex Rowley rightly identifies as an SNP tax increase on working people.
Ben McPherson.
I was clear that the policy has made a difference, but we know we're in a situation of public finance restraint. So I'm sure Mr Kerr will tell me where the cut will fall in the Conservative Party proposals on the revenue budget if they were to reinstate this.
Stephen Kerr.
That was, of course, the speech that Ben McPherson just gave. Kevin Stewart, who's not in his place, by the way, he might be best to ask the ministers how many of them gave up their ministerial cars to take advantage of this period of reduced price rail travel. But the Cabinet Secretary must accept that this is a cost of travelling by rail crisis of her own making. Because only John Swinney has more experience in government than her, so she knows how this works. To govern is to choose.
Yep.
Nigel Lawson said, to govern is to choose. To appear to be unable to choose is to appear to be unable to govern.
Yep.
Of course, we've heard the predictable and rather usual grievance agenda from what is now, I think, clearly accepted as an incompetent SNP government, because Scots across our country can now see straight through all of these excuses. No policy area is exempt. Getting people back on railways was never going to be simply about reducing price, because many other elements go into how people make their travel choices. But there's no question about it. The unaffordability of rail travel is an issue. It's also a naive assumption that cutting prices will automatically make up for the loss of revenue through increased demand.
Indeed.
I was involved in business for over 30 years, and one of the first lessons you learn in business is that if you cut your prices, it's very hard to get them up again. That's a reality, because people will exercise their choice. But this is classically how this SNP government governs. They never get to grips with any of the real issues that we're facing, because they're always far too busy trying to find an angle that will give them some political advantage when it comes to the only thing that they exist for, which is, of course, independence. Now, affordability, well, it's a fact. They can all, for all they like, that is the reality of the politics of this Parliament. It's all about independence. Now, the new peak fares about to be foisted on the Scottish people will drive people off the railways and back into cars. And under the new fares, the cost of a return peak journey from Stirling, for example, to Edinburgh will increase by 64.5% from £12.10 to £19.90. Between Perth and Glasgow, the rise is 100% from £20 to £40.10. And from Aberdeen to Inverness goes up 84% from £37.70 to £69.50. And I don't think it helps the government's case. And I know what the minister is going to say. I know what the minister is going to say. The minister is going to say, oh, they should buy an annual ticket or a monthly ticket. But that's not the reality. And by the way, it doesn't help the government's case that they've decided to reduce regularity of services on some of our major routes, because reduced services become less convenient and so less attractive to potential customers. And the suggestion that they're doing this to increase reliability is frankly ridiculous. Yep. Rachel Amory of The Scotsman made a video just last week detailing her typical journey from Perth to her offices here in Edinburgh. It took her nearly 2 hours to make that journey, which would have taken just over an hour when Queen Victoria was on the throne. Oh. So if the Cabinet Secretary wishes to understand why people who could use the train continue to use cars, I recommend that she watches Rachel's video. Yep. And it's worth reminding ourselves, for a whole section of the Scottish public, the opportunity to use any form of public transport is an alternative that is practically non-existent.
Mr. Kerr, you'll need to bring your remarks to a close now, please.
And so to conclude, the government will tell us in their favourite phrase, they take no lessons from anyone. How true that is, because
Mr. Kerr, you will
learn.
Need to conclude. Thank you very much. And I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Christine Graham. Mr. Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I remind members of my voluntary register of interests. Back in June, the last time Parliament debated peak fares, the Cabinet Secretary accused me of having a glass half-empty analysis and proceeded to give me a lecture on the savings ScotRail passengers were making. So the Cabinet Secretary was claiming the credit in June for rescuing Scotland's commuters from this cost of living crisis, but by August was blaming those very same commuters for being too middle and too upper class. Last week in Parliament, the Cabinet Secretary called them, let me quote, middle to upper income passengers. Well, I call them working class passengers. They are travelling by train before 9:30 in the morning and after 4:30 in the afternoon because they are going to and coming back from their work. In fact, I would like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to come with me one morning to Linlithgow Station. Look her constituents in the eye and tell them that they are all middle to upper earners, so can afford the big hike in rail fares which her government is imposing in 2 weeks' time. Let her try. Let her try and tell my constituents in Falkirk what she tried to tell us in Parliament just last week, that they can simply buy a FlexiPass with a 20% reduction or an annual season ticket with a 20% reduction, which it turns out is not a 20% reduction, but the equivalent of a 20% reduction. An annual season ticket to commute from Falkirk to Edinburgh costs over £2,500, which passengers have to pay up front. And if they pay it monthly, it costs them over £3,000 in a year. Is the Cabinet Secretary seriously arguing that people can easily afford this? And I suggest, too, that the Cabinet Secretary also listens to the ScotRail staff working in our stations, who tell me that rail passengers are being forced to give up their jobs because they cannot afford to commute anymore. We were told last week, in answer to questions posed by opposition MSPs, that one of the other reasons for reintroducing peak fares was variously because there was a limited increase in the number of passengers during the year. The fact is there were 4 million extra journeys. We were also told that the number of journeys had tailed off. But might that be because the number of trains had tailed off? Because the number of driver hours available had tailed off? And because a temporary timetable had been brought in so the chances of getting a seat on a train had tailed off. Finally, let me say this. When the First Minister was elected back in May, he told us of his commitment to transparency and openness. He emphasised the importance of Parliament in scrutinising our record and our plans. Yet barely 3 months later, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport puts out a press release days before Parliament is due to return, announcing the scrapping of the scheme, a pre-packaged decision accompanied by dishonest data behind the back of this Parliament. And it has taken an opposition party this week and a barrage of opposition MSPs' questions last week for the Cabinet Secretary to be forced to come to Parliament to explain herself, which in my view reflects not just a disdain for this Parliament, it reflects a disdain for democracy, but most of all, it reflects a disdain for the people, including all of those commuters whose votes send us here, when in return all they expect of us is that we act in the public interest, have consistency of principles, and promote the common good. I call on government ministers to remember that and reverse this disastrous decision.
Thank you, Mr Leonard. And I now call Christine Graham. Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, if gongs were being handed out for brass necks, everyone on the opposition benches would be wearing them, no doubt, proudly. Before the recent general election, the Office of Budget Responsibility and the Institute of Fiscal Studies were warning there was an £18 billion hole in the UK government finances. True to form, when Labour opened the books, it feigned shock that, in fact, it was £22 billion. But what's a billion or so between governments? Before the election, Anna's Read My Lips Sarwar proclaimed no austerity under Labour. Now the Starmer mantra is things will get worse. Pensioners already know what that means. Against that economic climate, the Tories in this debate and the previous on free school meals are demanding more money for services. On what planet do they live? Ditto for Labour. The ruin of the UK economy is simple. 2008, under Gordon Brown, the banks crashed, though he at least admitted he had, I quote, made a big mistake, close quotes. Boris pursued Brexit, slap bang in the middle of a global pandemic. So much for oven ready and £350 million a week for the NHS, side of a bus promise. As if things were not bad enough, along came 49-day Truss, who with a stroke of her quill crashed the economy, pushing inflation up to 11%. We would have been better off with a lettuce. At least that's good for your health. Yet somehow the Scottish Government, dependent for the majority of its funding from Westminster, has this very large sofa with coins just waiting to be liberated to provide year on that £40 million to subsidise on peak fares. To repeat, even with all that, this was a pilot scheme to move people back onto trains, especially after COVID, when they were all pretty well cut back of necessity and compliance on public transport. This was to be a specific return in passenger numbers for that money. It was not reached. End of pilot. A further comment. Work practices have radically changed since COVID. We moved to Teams, WhatsApp, Zoom, and still use these either fully or hybrid. Commuting to work for 5 days is for many in the past. The new balance of home working and office is here to stay. There are offices across Scotland, and Borders Council headquarters is one such, where weekdays it feels like the Marie Celeste. This place is just another such example. Some MSPs delivering speeches from their home. Mr Eagle actually delivered his from his lambing shed. Some time ago, Alec Hines, Chief Executive of ScotRail, and I discussed this change in work practices, and he advised their business model had to adapt. So ScotRail would look to increasing usage more through pleasure journeys because commuting has completely changed. But I wish, as always, to be consensual. So I look forward to the opposition parties in their closing speeches, because I know they've done their homework on this, to specify where that £40 million as a recurring annual cost is to come from. Health? Education? Or should we just scrap the millions we give every year simply to mitigate UK austerity? That would do it, because I've got news for them. There's no coin laid in sofa.
Thank you, Ms Graham. And we now move to closing speeches. And I call on Mark Ruscoe to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Yeah, thanks very much, Presiding Officer. Perhaps I could just address Christine Graham's comment there, because this is a bit of a frustrating debate, because we always talk about, you know, in this case, peak fares, higher prices to manage demand on the railways, but we never talk about peak pricing on the roads. We never talk about putting in charges on the roads to manage demand during periods of congestion, which, of course, Christine Graham, can then be used to invest in public transport and to actually invest in our road infrastructure as well. And the reality is that I think I'm short for time. The reality is that these are the choices that people, if they're fortunate enough to own a car and can drive, have to make every single day. Do you pick up the car keys, or do you pay upwards of £30 to travel to between Edinburgh and Glasgow on the railways? And the reality is that if you want to drive between Glasgow Queen Street and Edinburgh Waverley, it's actually free. There is no pricing on the roads. And yet we all know that private use of motor car results in cost to the economy, cost to the environment, cost to communities through the congestion. And to be honest, if you speak to people in France, they're quite frankly astonished that we don't have road pricing here, because they do have road pricing, and you can see the impact of that investment on the quality of the autoroutes and the roads in France, as well as the quality of their public transport. So I really hope the Cabinet Secretary is preparing to launch this much-wanted 20% vehicle mileage reduction route map, to give it its long title, in the weeks to come, because we need to get a grip on what are the acceptable measures to actually drive down demand. You know, Graham Simpson saying he doesn't back demand management, but you have to address the other side of this coin. And I want to just give one example, again from France, in Montpellier. Residents there have had free public transport since December, and in the first few months they've had that scheme. Passenger numbers have increased by about a quarter, and they pay for it through a mobility payment from companies with more than 11 employees, ticket sales from those visiting the town, and there's still significant public investment, which is funded by higher taxpayers, but they found a model to actually invest in their public transport that gives people a real choice to leave the car keys at home and get onto public transport. So we need to be open to new ways that we can invest in our infrastructure, our capital infrastructure, but also to support revenue measures like the scrapping of peak fares. Now, the Cabinet Secretary, I think, made a heroic attempt this afternoon, once again, of marketing the new plethora of tickets that are coming back, including, you know, super affirmative tickets that most people don't actually use because they're at times of the day that nobody needs them. And, of course, a lot of these longer-term tickets need a longer-term commitment as well from people to invest up front. So, as Beatrice Wishart said, you know, if you're going to design a ticket system to be a barrier to people to adopt public transport, then this would be it. It's too confusing. There was also the point that was made, I think, by Cabinet Secretary, that, you know, the people who really benefited from this pilot are those who are above average income. But we don't encourage people who are below average income to start to use the railways by increasing prices. And I think it was a strong point that was made by Richard Lellard and Alex Rowley. If we look at, you know, who gets the trains these days, it is middle earners, it is nurses, it is frontline workers. Those are the people that I see on the railways day in and day out. I know those are the people that the Fiona Hislop sees on her journey to work as well. So, you know, in closing, I would really urge the Cabinet Secretary to look for opportunities to fund a scheme like this going forward, but also to reconsider it. I know she made a commitment in the Chamber last week to reconsider this policy if a better budget deal comes from the Labour government in Westminster. I think we need to open up the conversation about how we fund these measures going forward, and I look forward to that coming in her route map to reducing vehicle mileage.
Thank you, Mr Ruscoe. I now call on Colin Smith to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This debate has highlighted the short-sightedness of the Scottish Government's decision to reintroduce peak fares. It's shown that positive policies are being sacrificed because of the SNP's mismanagement of our public finances. It's exposed the fact that the SNP has given up in Scotland's climate crisis, a crisis the Cabinet Secretary didn't even mention, with no serious plan to bring down emissions from our biggest emitter, transport. The 6.8% rise in passenger numbers as a result of axing peak fares was positive progress. It should have been built on, and it could have been, with proper long-term promotion of rail, a proper timetable of services, and a proper review of fares. As Alex Rowley said, we will not get more people back on our trains if those trains are not accessible, affordable and reliable. Instead, we'll soon have not a return to pre-pilot peak rail fares, but because of the 8.7% rail fare hike in April, Scotland's commuters will soon face the highest ever rail fares for peak journeys, but some of the poorest ever levels of service. And what angers, if I've got time to add on? No.
There is no extra time, it's a matter for the member.
What angers many of my constituents in Dumfries and Galloway is the fact that they will face the biggest hikes in fares in Scotland because of the failure of the government to change the illogical, irrational, discriminatory way ScotRail fixes its prices. Let me just give you one quick example. From the 27th of September, commuters travelling between Dumfries and Carlisle will see their day return rail fare rise from £7.60 to £23.50. That's an increase of 211%. Presiding officer, how do you explain that a day return on the same line from Kilmarnock to Glasgow will increase from £8.80 to £13.90, a bad enough 58%, but a similar distance return from Dumfries to Carlisle will increase four times that level to almost twice the price of the Kilmarnock to Glasgow return? What conceivable reason is there for the fact that a 40-mile journey on the Borders Railway from Tweedbank to Edinburgh will increase from £14.50 return to £21.70, an eye-watering 49%, but the cost of the shorter 30-mile journey from Dumfries to Carlisle will soon be more at £23.50, more expensive for a journey that's 25% shorter. And it's not just the Dumfries to Carlisle journey. On the same Nith Valley line, Dumfries to Glasgow will see an 80% hike in a day return fare. Passengers on the Nith Valley line who travel from Dumfries and Galloway find themselves paying significantly more per mile if their journey begins in the former in Dumfries and Galloway rather than in the former Strathclyde region. That's what a mess our fares are. You have the ridiculous situation, presiding officer, that passengers from Kirkconnell and Upernessdale are jumping in their car to drive the 5 minutes to New Cumnock to get the train to Glasgow there because the return fare is 25% cheaper than it is in Kirkconnell. From the 27th of September, that will be a saving of more than £10 per return journey just by driving a couple of miles up the road. When I raised these anomalies in the past with ministers, the response was, we're going to have a fares review. But the only substantive measure in that damp squib review on rail fares, the removal of peak fares, has now been ditched. Presiding officer, in 16 days' time, Scotland's rail commuters will be hit by record high fares. Bad news for families at a time they face a cost of living crisis. In just 16 days, more people will move from using the train to using the car. That's bad news for our environment. And in 16 days' time, after 17 years of inaction by this tired, failing government, my constituents have never been further away from fairer fares when it comes to Scotland's rip-off rail fares.
Thank you. And I call on Fiona Hislop. Up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding officer, public transport is a key enabler for economic and social growth, providing that vital link between where people live, they learn, they earn and they socialise. Access to affordable and reliable public transport services helps people and communities unlock opportunities to connect to jobs, education, retail, public services, leisure, recreation, friends and family and networks. And Labour's amendment reflects our transport strategy wording, so I am happy to vote for it. This SNP government, of course, chose to extend and fund the pilot again in June after the ending of the Bute House Agreement. No, I'm going to progress because I want to address some of the points in the debate. This pilot was a bold initiative which aimed to simplify complex fares and ticketing options and encourage more people to choose to travel by train rather than by car. However, despite the government's call, and on 6 June during Mr Ruskell's members' debate, urging all members, the rail unions and others to encourage more work colleagues, family, friends and neighbours to switch to rail for more journeys, we just did not achieve the shift required to justify the funding to continue the removal of ScotRail peak fares. Now, the analysis shows that the pilot did not make a significant contribution to the First Minister's four priorities, particularly tackling child poverty and climate change. And instead, it primarily benefited existing train passengers. However welcome that has been over the last year by them. And can I say to Richard Leonard, I regularly use the train, and I was at Linlithgow train station only this morning. To Graham Simpson, I want to address the point he made about cancellations. He referred to 5,000 cancellations, and I'm not sure he realises that ScotRail operates an average of more than 1,800 trains each day. Last year had 82 million passenger journeys. ScotRail had fewer compensation claims last year than the year before, when it moved fewer customers. And ScotRail has fewer than one claim per 1,000 passengers, which compares with nearly 5 claims per 1,000 across the rest of GB Rail. On the points that Alec Rowley made, and I think this is really important in looking at the figures, he refers to the impact that he thinks happened on the figures because of the emergency timetable that was introduced in early July. Can I reassure him the figures that we have used were taken in early July before the move to the emergency timetable? And I also want to point out to Mark Ruskell, and be aware that in terms of that Edinburgh-Glasgow line, if you use a weekly season ticket 4 days, it will be £24. If you lose a flexi pass, it will be £21.25. And I think he and Beatrice Wishart made an important point about how do you make it easier for people. And she talked about people working 3 days a week. That's why the flexi pass changes have been made, to enable 6 return journeys over that 2-month period, resulting in a 32% return. And I'm sure she and her colleagues will publicise that. And of course, in terms of the timing of decision that I'm being criticised for, the decision had to be taken in August to enable the ticket process to be amended, or decision taken to continue the pilot in order to deliver that. Presiding Officer, of course, none of these financial pressures that are affecting some of the decisions that we're having to make here matters to either Scottish Labour or the Tories. They don't care that first the Tory Westminster government and now the Labour Westminster government have imposed financial constraints on themselves, on us, and indeed on the people of Scotland. Things, as we are told by the Prime Minister, are going to get worse in public finance. The Westminster Labour government is warning us of a very difficult autumn budget. Now, there are big, bold things we want to deliver and achieve for Scotland's railway, but we are constantly constrained financially year to year and through in-year pressures. These are coming externally from successive Westminster governments, once Tory, now Labour, and without complete control over all the powers, the levers and the resources Scotland needs, we will always, always be held back.
Michael Mara, this must be brief. Thank you. Can I have Mr Mara's microphone? Thank you.
Thank you. What would the Minister have to say to the Institute for Fiscal Studies, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who made it absolutely clear that the issues in the budget are their own responsibility?
Thank you. Mr Mara, I can say at this point that the Cabinet Secretary had in fact sat down, and it is now, of course, time to hear from Douglas Lumsden to wind up the debate. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to support this motion today calling on this devolved Scottish Government to reverse their poor decision on reintroducing peak time fares on our railways. Once again, we see this SNP Government failing to listen to the Scottish people, failing to listen to the Scottish businesses, failing to listen to the rail unions, failing to listen to our tourism sector, and failing in their promises. This is quite simply a tax on those who are seeking to go about their daily lives and trying to do so responsibly. And I've spoken many times to this chamber about how the Scottish people want to do their bit. They want to be environmentally responsible. They want to help us all achieve net zero, but are being stymied time and time again by this short-sighted and visionless SNP government. And the amendment they bring today sum up a government that is out of ideas and out of time. They try and pat themselves on the back by calling the removal of peak fares pioneering, but they ditched it and, of course, try and blame Westminster once again. This government owns ScotRail. It has full control over ScotRail. It should do anything it can to encourage more people onto ScotRail to enable the modal shift that we desire. But what we are seeing from the SNP government is actions.
Mr. Lumsden, if I might just ask you to stop for a moment. I'm very aware that there are conversations, some in fact are carrying on, even as I suggest that members might like to hold them when we're finished with chamber business this evening. Mr. Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What we're seeing from the SNP government is actions that are driving people away from the railways, reintroducing peak fares that will see fares double in some places. Services Act, 6,000 trains cancelled as a temporary timetable introduced. Then let's look at journey times, as mentioned by Stephen Kerr. In 2016, the devolved SNP government promised to spend £200 million by 2026 to reduce journey times between Aberdeen and the Central Belt by 20 minutes. This would have provided the North East with a huge economic boost and encouraged more people onto the railway. But nearly 8 years on, we find that less than 5% of that promised money has been spent, and we are now told that the project is under review. Another broken promise, just like the promise to dual the A96, like the promise to dual the A9 by 2025, just like the promise to dual the A90 north of Ellen. A list of broken promises to the North East by this SNP government. Now, moving on to some of the contributions we've heard today. Craig Hoy reminded us about the temporary alcohol ban on ScotRail, introduced nearly 4 years ago. But this government is so weak it cannot make up its mind what to do. A succession of transport ministers seem incapable of making a decision. Graeme Simpson rightly reminded us that the SNP government have ditched their climate change targets. Probably a good job when they make public transport much more expensive. He also points out that the flawed survey highlighted by his new friends in the RMT. We heard from the Cabinet Secretary once again pass the buck to Westminster, even though the Scottish Fiscal Commission has it in their publications that the overall budget is up 0.9% in real terms this year. Alec Rowley is spot on when he says we should be targeting drivers and make rail as attractive choice as possible. Then we'll get the modal shift. The government has set a target of 20% reduction in car mile journeys by 2030, but once again, they have no plan. Mark Ruskell is right to say that fares are extortionate and confusing. We need to simplify, not forcing people to buy flexi passes or whatever they're called. And more time was needed for the pilot. Ben McPherson and Christine Graham both said, where's the money coming from? Well, these are political choices, so I'll give them some ideas where the money can come from. Scrap the National Care Service. Scrap the independence unit that they spend money on. Trim the constitution budget. Grow the economy at the same rate as the rest of the UK. Then we'd have plenty of money to spend on things that Scots actually want. Presiding Officer, the fact is that only 2% of journeys in Scotland are made by rail. The decision to reintroduce peak fares will not increase that figure. The decision to pause the journey time reduction project to Aberdeen will not increase that figure. The decision to kick new stations like the one at Winchborough, campaigned for by my colleague Sue Webber, into the long grass will not increase this figure. You have to make it easier for people. We would scrap peak fares and introduce a Scottish smart travel card that can be used on all forms of public transport. Smart card is another SNP broken promise. The people of Scotland want to do their bit when it comes to net zero. They want to travel sustainably, but are being prevented from doing so by this SNP government. This government is making it harder and more expensive for Scots to use our trains. Cancelled and delayed services, increased costs on fares, and poor connectivity. But, Presiding Officer, it's not too late for the government to change its mind on this policy. It's not too late to announce that peak fares will be abolished permanently and hard-working Scots will not be penalised for trying to do the right thing and use the train. Yeah. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on ending peak rail fares on ScotRail trains. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 14417 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. And the question is that motion 14417 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 14418 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a Stage 2 timetable. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion, therefore. The question is that motion 14418 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask Jamie Hepburn, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 14419 on committee membership and 14420 on substitution on committees.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And the question on these motions will be put at decision time, and there are seven questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 14406.3 in the name of Jenny Gilruth, which seeks to amend Motion 14406 in the name of Liam Kerr on free school meals for all primary pupils, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.